Welcome back. We're glad you're watching The Business Show. Now, I think it's a given that across the entire country, there's been so much rain, yeah? And I've seen people say things like, we cannot make as much because of the rains. It's understandable. It's understandable because, look, most of our people in the markets are not actually inside. We know that the markets that were built by government, but not everyone operates from inside. Now, we can only hope that you can maximize on every small opportunity that you have to try make some money, because that's more or less the reason you're waking up every single day. All right, let's talk how then to make the money, actually.
First of all, my name is Joseph Nkando. I'm the executive director of New Cafe. New Cafe is the National Association of Coffee Farmers. It is a membership organization owned and run by farmers themselves. As a membership organization, to date, we have over 1.5 million smallholder coffee farmers that are part of New Cafe, and they are organized within the communities where they produce coffee in over 200 associations and cooperatives. New Cafe runs on the farmer ownership model. What this means is that farmers take ownership by taking responsibility as masters of their own destiny. It means that farmers don't wait for somebody to come and say, oh, I'm giving you this. Not at all. You know, from within the farmers, we say we need to be self-sustaining. And this is a pain that we have to go through for the current, but also future generations. The problem we are working on is that for a long time, coffee farmers have been earning less than 5% of their retail value. And this is the most important thing that we are working on as New Cafe, to ensure that we break the intergenerational poverty that has been characterized with the farmers from generation to generation. And not any other model that can do that. It is the farmer ownership model. But we know how hard it is for us to ensure that the farmer ownership model becomes the normal business model for not only the coffee value chain, but also other agricultural value chain. So what happens with the farmer ownership model? As farmers produce their coffee, New Cafe is at their disposal to empower them, to train them, to pass on the necessary skills for them to produce the quality of coffee that is needed by the consumer. So the farmer must be able to speak the language that the consumer understands. And therefore, New Cafe is there to ensure that it passes on what kind of attributes that the consumer is looking for in the coffee. So the handling practices, the good agricultural practices, the climate smart solutions that are needed at the farm level are key for New Cafe to carry on with all its members. Now, after the farmers produce the coffee has to be brought to the various processing centers of New Cafe. And therefore, when it arrives there, that's when New Cafe is supposed to make a part payment. It can be 50%, it can be 60%, depending on the availability of capital. This is where it is always so challenging, for us to make sure that we have the available, capital. So the farm ownership model calls for value addition. And value addition, it means you have to take a bit of time for you to be able to add value to the farmer's coffee. And this is where a part payment becomes important, such that farmers can wait when New Cafe is adding value to their coffee. So these investments are a key component of adding value to farmers' coffee. The 7-in-1 factories that we have at a one-stop center here in Namanve are very, very important in the transformation that we are looking for in Uganda's coffee industry. I think everyone is aware that coffee marketing was liberalized, and therefore it is the market forces that determine, you know, prices. So as producers, what we embarked on, and especially Uganda, is to produce the quality, maximum quality of coffee, high quality of coffee. And we are involved in the production of specialty coffee, which is of highest quality. And therefore, we are selling quality. So it is that quality that we use to determine, you know, the price of coffee. Nobody will tell you that there is this body that determines the price of coffee. Not even the International Coffee Organization. International Coffee Organization is simply a coordinator, an organization that gathers statistics to do with the coffee from all over the world, from all over its members. Okay, so that's what ICO, the International Coffee Organization, is doing. It does not regulate prices, not at all. It is the market forces that do that. So the sellers and buyers meet and determine, you know, the prices. Of course, we must be aware that there is a lot of speculation that goes on in the marketplace. And this is the evil that has been characterized with the coffee value chain for ages, and that we must work hard as producer organizations to ensure that even within our own countries, we create a domestic market, such that the market is near with us, and that we can, you know, play around with the prices, and that we know nobody will come to say that this is how we are going to increase the prices. We are very much aware that consumption and the demand of coffee is much higher than what is produced. But because of speculation, they tend to play around with the prices such that they can go down. But even with that, we have seen in the recent past, especially in this year 2022, how prices, you know, have come up. Prices are supposed to be up, okay? But prices of raw commodities will never always, you know, be stable. So eventually what we have to struggle for is to ensure that we manufacture what we produce into a finished product. But of course we must know the global political economy of coffee.
So of what importance was the International Coffee Organization to Uganda's visibility, and how will this affect Uganda in that we are taking a 2 years break from that, from the organization?
Yeah, of course the importance is that it is always important to be in a club. Okay? And you try to come up with issues whereby the club members can agree upon. Okay? But the point we are making is that there are issues that producer countries of coffee have always come up with to ensure that, you know, members of International Coffee Organization can agree upon. Let me, you know, look at what is the membership of the International Coffee Organization. First of all, the International Coffee Organization is an intergovernmental organization. Okay? Its membership is of producing and importing countries. Okay? And by governments. So it is member countries. Meaning that at the round table of International Coffee Organization, you have importing countries, you have exporting countries or producer countries. So you are not alone. Okay? Now at that table you are discussing the point Uganda is fronting and other producer countries, not alone as Uganda, is that there is a lot that needs to be done at that round table of ICO. To listen to coffee producing countries, they would wish to add more value to coffee and export it as a finished product. Okay? But in importing countries, what is happening? There are stringent conditions on a finished product in terms of food safety. These food safety requirements are that stringent that for one to penetrate a market is not easy, okay? And who owns these stringent conditionalities? It is the importing countries. And you must be aware that these food safety requirements are very subjective, okay? So where we are coming from, we are coming from a point of high tariffs on value-added products. But point came and say, okay, now it is free entry into the market. But the main issue now is to do with food safety requirements. And these are difficult, you know, to meet. And they are costly even because you have to meet certain, you know, standards. So these are all conditionalities that prevent coffee producing countries from adding value and export, you know, a finished product into the developed world. So these are issues that are pertinent and that ICO agreements need to put into consideration. So the point is the International Coffee Agreement 2007 expired and then they called for an extension. But you are extending within an agreement that is not catering for your needs that are transformative. Okay? So we should do appreciate the fact that these needs have to be taken into account. And we should appreciate the fact that if you are a member of a certain body and it is not catering for your needs, why should you stay? And it has expired. And by the way, is it Uganda that has first declared itself? No. Even the mighty United States of America has been pulling out and coming back, pulling out and coming back.
Sometimes I keep saying you have every excuse for not starting, but you also have no excuse for not starting. That's it. Some of you have the money, but you just won't start. And then there are people that don't have money, but want to start. So listen, if you have a business idea and you feel you want to start, get the basics right. I keep talking about these things. Things like, what product are you offering? Does the market need your product? Target audience. Or you're the type that is going to produce goods for everyone. Location. Yeah. Pricing. Production capacity. So when you pay attention to all this, then you will start find, you discover that, yes, I think where I am going, I can break even after this period of, you know, maybe 3 months, 6 months, 1 year. But also, given all those factors, it's also important that you actually take a given. I know people that have still started something, even in that space where others have been operating. Listen, I keep saying that if people are in some space, it does not mean necessarily that they are thriving. Some of them are in those places, but they are struggling. And they're struggling because of poor management of their businesses. So for you, you could still step in and make something happen. So don't give up because others are failing. Everyone has their chances. I keep saying opportunities are like buses. There's definitely another one coming at the next stage. So give it a shot. Who knows? The thing could just work out. Let's talk personal finance tips for this week and hear the basics on what you need to do to manage your finances.
Welcome to this segment as we talk about investment once again, and please introduce yourself.
Thank you, Cynthia. Charles Katongole, Head of Financial Markets with Standard Chartered Bank.
Okay, thanks. So we've been talking about investments, and today we are talking about something very interesting, retirement. Mm-hmm. Retirement, retirement, retirement. We hear it all the time, and when we are younger, we don't think it's important because we still have time. So first of all, tell us, what is retirement?
Well, it's a very interesting question. And I think it's different for everyone. Your definition of what retirement is will definitely be different from mine, will be different from anyone else watching and listening. But I guess the best way I can really define it, for me, retirement would be that ability for you to be able to do what you want, when you want, for however long you want, with whoever you want. So you're in a space where you choose what to do, when to do it, how to do it, with who to do it, for how long, however long you want to do it, without impacting your life. I'll give an example. If I wanted to go and watch Chelsea play Arsenal, watch Chelsea beat Arsenal repeatedly, can I do that on Monday, on Tuesday, and I want to go with my family, you understand, and sit at the beach? Can I do that? If I can do that without impacting my life, I think
you would have achieved your retirement goal.
I would have achieved retirement.
Oh, wow.
Now, if I'm not in that space, I may stop working. So you haven't retired. All you've done is changed employers.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so as I said, it's different for everyone. But in my view, for me, you retire when you get into that space where you don't have pressure. You're in a good space where you do the things you want, when you want, with whoever you want, for however long you want to do it. And that's not impacting the rest of your life.
Oh, wow.
Then you have retired.
I find that so interesting and so insightful, and a different way of looking at retirement.
Mm-hmm.
So how should one start planning for retirement?
Yeah. And I guess once we've now defined what retirement is,
uh-huh,
what you're really doing is buying time.
Okay.
As in saving time, for lack of a better word. You want to save time and resources for you to be able to enjoy that freedom. So we work backwards. So I want to be able to do the things I want,
mm-hmm,
when I want.
Mm-hmm.
When do I want to be able to do that?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
So I want to be able to do that in 5 years. Now, in 5 years, would I have built sufficient backstock or resources to allow me to do that,
mm-hmm,
and to do that for the rest of my life? So that's how I'd really approach it. If I realize I won't be able to, then that means that my retirement time is not going to be 5 years. It's going to be maybe 10, 15, 20 years, maybe 30 years.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing you need to consider is we're living longer, way longer. I think the average age, I think it must be north of 60 now, the life expectancy,
mm-hmm,
for Ugandans.
Mm-hmm.
And taking into consideration that we have high child mortality, so all that is going there, high maternal, it's coming down, yeah? But once you factor in all those, yeah, then you realize that 65 probably means for people who are maybe living well, you're feeding properly, you're probably going to live, chances are that you live to your 70s and 80s.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Now, usual active employment stops at, by law, I think it's 60.
Mm-hmm.
So chances are that you still have an extra 20 something years.
Okay.
Within which to live,
mm-hmm.
and be able to do the things you want. So you need to build a buffer that would probably cover you beyond active employment for those that are actively employed.
Mm-hmm.
Or you need to start accelerating that building of that reserve,
mm-hmm.
if it's not. Say, let's assume that when you leave active employment or whatever you're doing,
mm-hmm.
your monthly costs are what? Let's say 1 million shillings. That's what you're living with. So you want to be able to maintain, as I said, without affecting your life, you want to be able to maintain that cost base. Now, if you want to travel, as you mentioned, what is it, the place that people like going? The ladies?
Bahamas.
Santorini, is it? Yeah, in
I know
Greece.
Bahamas.
Uh-huh. Bahamas. Yeah, so you need to be able to sponsor that. And remember, you're not actively employed or engaged anymore.
Yes.
So you need to be able to have
that. So how
do you
build the pool? Talk about, for instance, I hear pension. What types of pensions are there?
Yeah. So we've defined the time.
Yes.
We've defined what you need.
Okay.
In terms of the actual cash that you'd probably need to expend. You have defined that. Now you need the asset to generate that income. So we do have the National Pension Scheme.
First, what's
NSSF.
An asset?
An asset is something that produces economic value.
Okay.
Over time. Economic value for any, lack of a better word, something that generates money.
Whatever brings money in my pocket.
Yeah, whatever
is
generates
an asset.
That's an asset for you.
Cool.
If it generates
okay.
money, it's
mm-hmm.
it's an
so
asset.
Continuing.
On your side. So we've worked out the time you want
yes.
to retire, so you're working backwards. You know how much you need for you to sustain that life and fun that you want. Now you build that asset
okay.
that's going to generate that income for you.
So the war in Sudan is causing a bit of mayhem on businesses, I should say. Just at a time when you're thinking, okay, maybe we should be able to transact across the neighbors and all that, then all these things happen. But for now, what is important is that, you know, government is bring back the people. Evacuation is very important for them. You know, the safety of our people is important, and then we can start with the business later. So if you're safe, we thank God. If you're on the way, all the same, good stuff. But here on the business show, we're telling you that there are basics that are very important for your success as a business person. Now, before we go, this is what you need to remember about your businesses. You are the owner of that business, and you are the reason your business thrives. Okay? So pay attention to detail. Let's run you through the Forex and money markets for this week. So that then should do for this week's edition. Thank you so much for making time on the program. Feel free to get in touch with us on our socials right below your screen. Tell us what you think about the show. Also, if there's anything you want to learn that you think can inspire you moving forward, get in touch with us. You can reach us here at the New Vision headquarters in Kampala. We'll be more than glad to respond to your requests and help you connect up with the people that you think inspire you to run your business. Also, for those of you facing challenges, there's always an opportunity for you to speak to those who have made it. Ask. I keep saying competition is good. Ask those who have made it, and they will help you with the basics or some of the things they got right to succeed. Otherwise, for me and the team, it's thank you so much for watching. We'll see you soon, and bye for now.